In this video, you're going to learn everything that you need to know to be able to work with and use very effectively the new useActionState hook from React. This is a hook that got introduced in React 19, and it's a hook that we mostly use to handle forms effectively that also works in both a client and a server environment. So get ready, get excited, because I promise you, you are going to learn a lot in this video. All right, cool. So let's begin. So here I'm on the official react.dev documentation on the useActionState page over here, which you can have access to. You can go look this up. It is going to teach you literally everything that you want to know about how to use useActionState. We're going to loosely follow this documentation over here, but I'm going to give you my version of it and try to give you a complete example that actually makes sense and that gives you the best understanding of how to use this hook. So as I said, right, useActionState, as you can see here in this example, is a hook that we mostly use for forms. So we're going to be doing now something similar, and I'm going to show you how to set up a simple form using useActionState and why you would want to use useActionState as opposed to something else. So here in my editor, I have a very simple application. It is important to note that, as you can see here, maybe not because my face is here, but trust me, this is a Next.js application, but this does not mean that you have to use Next.js to be able to use useActionState. The only reason I'm using Next.js is because it makes it super simple for me to show you both the client and the server at the same time. But you do not have to use Next.js. You can use useActionState purely with React in a client-only environment. Now, because we are working in Next.js, what happens is everything by default is a server component, which we don't want, at least for this example. We want to do things on the client. So we're going to come in here at the top, and we're going to put useClient to make this component behave as a client component, or rather to be a client component. And then what we have here is essentially an empty form. We have this form tag over here, and then a button that is going to submit the form. What we now want to do is we want to use useActionState to both provide the functionality of submitting the form through the action property of the form, but also to show the actual current state of the form as we submit the actions and even before we submit the action. And for that, we are going to be using useActionState. So let's come here at the top of the component and let's start defining our useActionState. And this syntax, as you can see here, is going to be very similar to useState, which is hopefully something that you're already very familiar with. We're going to do const, and then we're going to open up an array here, which can have a few elements. We're going to be using two elements for now. Then we're going to build upon this. The first one is going to be the state, as cursor is telling me very nicely. And the second one is going to be the action over here. Now we're going to make this use action state, which we can import directly from React. And then we're going to be able to call this with some specific parameters. Now, use action state, if you hover over this, expects 2 to 3 arguments. The first argument is going to be the actual action that we want to call whenever we submit this form. That is going to be an asynchronous function that is going to run some code and can return to us some data that is then going to go directly in the state property over here and cause this component to re-render. And then the second argument is going to be the initial value of this state property over here. We can provide null, we can provide undefined if we want to, but we have to provide a specific value. So let's now start giving useActionState the arguments that it needs. I'm going to come here in our sidebar, and inside of the src folder, I'm just going to make a new file called actions that is going to hold and export our asynchronous function. In here, because we are working in Next.js, we're going to mark this as useServer to make sure that these actually get converted to endpoints that we can then call on the client. Again, if you're using pure React on the client side, you don't have to do this. This is just something specific that we are because we're using Next.js. And then over here, we can just export an asynchronous function that we can call action to keep it very simple. And this action is going to do some things. Now, here's the important part. Whenever you're using useActionState with an action, that action needs to then take a specific signature in terms of its parameters. The first one is going to be the previous state, which we're going to call this like this, pref state. And then the second one is going to be form data like this, which is going to be of type form data. Now, again, if you're not using TypeScript, don't worry about these types. You can just ignore them if you're using JavaScript. But if you are using TypeScript, this is the type of form data. And then pref state over here can be any state that we've defined here for our state, which currently has no state. It's undefined, which means that ultimately we can now control what this previous state is going to be. Now, to make things simple, for this simple example, I'm going to define this as a number over here. Our previous state is going to be a number, and then we're going to use that number inside of the body of the function to do something to it and then return that number back to useActionState. So in the body of the function, we can do the simplest thing possible. We can just do prev state and then plus one, and we can then just return all of this here, right? So we're going to take the previous state, whatever it was previously when this action was submitted, we're going to increment it by one, and then we're just going to return it back to useActionState. And with that, our action for now is done. Do not worry about the fact that we're not using this form data here. We have to keep this because this is the signature of the action when passing it to useActionState. But after, I'm going to show you an example that is going to be form data related, because that's also important. Then over here, we can come back to our application, and now we can start passing our arguments to useActionState. So we can do action over here, which we can import directly over here. And actually, I should have maybe renamed this to form action. This is going to be a little bit clearer. Then we can import this from actions over here, and we can pass as the second argument our initial value of the state, which again can be undefined, can be null, can be a string, can be anything, but we defined it here as a number. So we're going to initialize it with a value as a number. And then now we have our state, we have our form action, which means that we can use these directly in the components and start attaching things. So let's make some space here. Let's come here, and on the form, we're going to pass form action as the action property. And then over here, we're just going to put here the state like this, which ultimately is going to be the value of our action. So now we have a form on the action property. We're going to do this thing here, which is going to get submitted by this button over here. And then that state should represent and be updated with the value of our state as we actually call this action. Let's test it out. So here we have our button. I can press submit, and it's going to see here the UI is a little bit funky. Let's just maybe add a class name over here that we can do this so it looks a little better. There we go. Now we can actually submit this, and our count, right, our state is going up as a result of our action. This is in the simplest form how you can use action state to actually submit a form and get live feedback, live re-renders from your React components. Cool. So now let's take it one step further, and let's start actually using this form data property here and putting some actual form fields and getting the data from the form fields directly in this component. So first, we are going to remove this zero over here, and we're going to start this with undefined. And this is going to give us some type errors because our action here is now expecting a number and we're not providing a number. That is fine. We're going to be updating this as we're making changes. Then in here, I'm going to come and remove this state because now we're not going to use this state in exactly the same way. And now we're just going to put some input that can have some value. For example, a text input that can have a username value here, right? So now we have some data in our form so that when we submit the data, we're actually going to be able to access that data in this action over here through the form data property and then do some things with it. For example, we can come here and remove this line over here, and then we can do const username equals form data dot get username. And then if we're working in TypeScript, we're going to alias this as a string so that we know that we have a string. And then we can now do anything that we want with this username. For example, we can perform some very simple and basic validation, like checking the length of the username if it's less than 3. And then we can actually return something as a result of this check. We can return an object that says success false. And then we can put here a message that says username must be at least 3 characters long. Again, it's completely up to us what we return here. We can do this in any way that we want. What matters here is that we are actually returning something from this action over here, which remember is now going to go back into this state property here, which we can then use as in the side of this form. And then if the username is greater than 3, then we can just return here success true, and then we can put username updated to, and then pass the username here. And now this is also going to show up in our actual UI. Now, of course, it's not going to show up right now because we have to implement that, but we can do that in a few simple steps. Now, you're going to see that we still have an error over here. The type here is still incorrect, and I'm not going to go into this type, but it's saying here that the pref state and state are incompatible. Essentially, our pref state over here no longer matches what we actually have defined over here. Now, because we are defining this as undefined, that is totally fine. What we can then do is we can just do any here because we are not going to be using this pref state in this function anymore. So we don't really care what type this is. This is fine to do this in an action. You can do this. It's okay. And now you're going to see that we no longer have any errors over here, any type errors. But if I hover over the state property, we're still getting the correct type. We're still getting state that can be an object with success as a Boolean and then message as a string, or it can be undefined, right? Because it's in initial state is going to be undefined. You could also come in here and put that exact same type in here, right? If you want to get rid of this any, and in some cases you should, but for this simple tutorial, I'm just going to keep it like that. And then what we can do is now we have this state property over here. This form is going to work exactly in the same way. What we can then do is actually show a message to the user if the validation was a failure, like we have here, or if the validation was a success like we have here. So let's do that. So we're going to come in here and we're going to make here, and we're going to do state and then question mark, because again, this can be optional. And then we're going to do here dot message, and then we're going to pass here state.message. So if we have a message, we're going to pass the message. And then just to make things a little bit simpler, we're actually going to give this a color. So if the message is success, we're going to give this a green color. And if the message is not success, if it's a failure, we're going to give this a red color, just like this. Now, if we save, we're accessing the state property here. We're checking the message. And then based on the message, we're going to render it in the correct color. Let's test this out. So here's our new form. We have our input here. If we submit this right now, we're going to get an error. Username must be at least 3 characters long. Perfect. If we put something here, 123 test, we're going to see username updated to the test. Our action using useActionState works exactly as we expect. Well, now there's more that we can do with this. There's another parameter here, another argument that you can access from useActionState, and that is going to be the is pending property here. This is pending here is going to be a boolean that represents, is this action currently pending? Because remember, this is an asynchronous function, which means that it can take time and it will take time to complete. It will not complete synchronously. So if it does take some time, we can then use this as pending to show something in our UI to tell the user that, hey, something is currently happening. So for us to see that, we can then come in here and we can just do await, and then we can just await an empty promise that is going to resolve after 1 second, just to simulate some sort of network delay. And then we can come back here to our is pending, and inside of this button here, we can just do, we can is pending, and we can put submitting or submit, right? So if is pending is true, we're going to put submitting. Otherwise, we're just going to put submit. So let's now test this out and see how is pending actually affects our form. I press submit, it's submitting for 1 second, and then we get the response. Username must be at least 3 characters long. I put test over here, submitting, and then we get the success response that the username has been updated to. Great, so now this works, but there is one more thing that we want to do. And that thing is, what if you want to actually send an argument to this action function here, an extra argument that is not part of these two arguments? Because I said that when you use an action like this with useActionState, you are locked to this function signature here. But sometimes you want the arguments. For example, if we're updating a specific user, we want to get the ID of the user to then be able to use it inside of this function to actually update the correct ID of the correct user. Now, there are multiple ways that you can do that, but I'm going to show you the simplest way to achieve this. So let's just assume that we had some const ID, and that would be one, summer. Let's assume that, you know, for simplicity, this would come through props from the home, right? It doesn't really matter where it comes from. All that matters is we actually have this ID here that is coming from somewhere. The easiest way for us to actually plug it into the form is we can just come in here and we can put an input of type hidden. We can give it here its ID, and then we can pass it here the value, right? This input is now going to go as part of the form. It is going to be hidden, so we're not going to see it in the actual UI. Although we will be able to see it if we inspect the console, but that's usually fine. And then we're going to be able to access that ID through this form data, just like we access the username, right? So we can come in here above and we can do const ID equals form data.get ID. And then we can use this ID. For example, we can say user and then ID updated to username, right? So let's test this out. So we can come in here and we can do test, and then we can wait for 1 second. And then we're going to see user one updated to test. And that is how you can send parameters to your forms through useActionState. And there you go. In this really simple example, I've managed to show you everything that is related to useActionState and how it actually works. You know how to submit a form, you know how to pass data, you know how to use the isPending flag and all the properties over here, and you generally know and can now use this in your own applications at will. Now, before I end this video, I just want to make a quick mention and tell you why you would want to use useActionState as opposed to just using the form on submit. If you've been building forms in React for the past, you know, couple of years or so, we've been doing forms through the on submit, right? So we have here the form, we can do on submit, and then we can put some function here. And we would usually have to prevent the default behavior, as you can see here, and then do something, right? That all works, but the on submit requires us to be in a client environment. It requires us to be on the browser. Now that React is moving to the server as well as the client, we now have to, if we're working in a server environment, or if the JavaScript is not there yet on the browser, we now have to revert back to the action property. The action property is a standard HTML property that can work without JavaScript. So if here we have this client component here, if we're actually submitting this form before the JavaScript bundle has loaded, then what would happen is we're just going to submit a default action as if we would to a default form in HTML without JavaScript. And this can only be possible because we have this action property here, which is what useActionState give us. If we were using any other sort of first solution or just a normal function with onSubmit, we would not be able to do this and our form would not submit without JavaScript. So that is in a nutshell why you want to use this. And this is the future of React and the future of forms in React. And there are libraries that are now building upon this to actually provide a very nice developer experience that bridges all the good things about running this on the server and also all the good things that we know and love about running forms on a client, just like we were for the past history of React. If you enjoyed this video and you want to see more videos just like this one, make sure to leave this video a big thumbs up. You can also click here to subscribe, or you can click here to watch a different video of mine that YouTube seems to think that you're really going to enjoy. And with that being said, my name has been Darius Kozin. This is Kozin Solutions. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in the next video. Ciao, ciao.